Hi and welcome to Let's Talk, all about books, social media and good times going on in Auckland. Carole Beu's in shortly with an enticing read from the Women's Bookshop, and I'll be talking about my word of the week, which is curate. This week's guest author, Ian Grant, top Kiwi father figure, has just written an acutely challenging book about fathering. But first up, in our What's Happening in Auckland spot, we're meeting Erin Fay from Alphabet City. It's a community art space and gallery in Eden Terrace that focuses on the written word, letterpress printing, bookbinding, zines, printmaking and book arts, and even hosts a letter writing club. Hello, Erin. Welcome to Let's Talk. It's great to have you in here.
Hello. Thank you so much.
Now, a gallery space that's all about books and words and printing and bookbinding and things, it sort of kind of sounds like an exercise in nostalgia.
No, I don't really think so. I think it's a really active practice, and these things have never gone away. There's more technology now, however, that doesn't mean that the old technology has disappeared.
Yeah, and that's a 500-year-old art, really, isn't it, what you're talking about, is all of the different ways of getting words, primarily on paper, I guess, and binding them, putting them in a really nice wrapping.
People have always told stories. As long as there have been language, there's been stories. And so we're really interested in the ways in which people share stories and communicate in different ways. Yeah.
When you sat down next to me, I noticed you have this really interesting tattoo on your arm which says, "I'm telling you stories, trust me." So where does that come from?
It comes from a Jeanette Winterson novel, The Passion, just my favorite book. So.
Are we missing stories in the world these days, do you think? Or is there such a welter of stories that it is harder to sort out the goodies from the baddies?
I don't think so. Mm. I think that all stories are valid. It's just, you know, some are told more craftily than others, and it's just how you like to access stories. We're not really focused on one way of telling stories over another, but we are interested in works on paper and print and creating things.
Right. Now, where are you from? I can tell from your voice you're not a local girl.
No. I'm from New York City, from Brooklyn.
Okay. So this feels to me like a very New York sort of thing to do. I imagine that you need to be in a loft somewhere and that lots and lots of interesting people from the neighborhood come around and have a play. Is that how it works?
Well, I think, you know, there are Center for Book Arts all over the world, and New Zealand really didn't have one. So we really wanted to make a space that was about words and printing and self-publishing, that so people could come along and anyone could learn these skills and these tools.
And are you finding that you've created a niche that people are loving to step into?
People really love to visit. Yeah. Whenever people walk in the door, they just get really excited. And we've had the opportunity to collaborate with a lot of interesting people and do a lot of fun projects.
Yeah. Now, what have you brought with you? You've brought some.
So I brought some M's. So we are one of the few places that you can go and learn letterpress printing in New Zealand.
Right.
And letterpress is about movable type. And so these are some
done by Mr. Gutenberg all those years ago.
And so movable type is about typing that you can move. And so we're all about hand setting one letter at a time. And these are some of our largest letters.
Okay, you have to have a really big frame to put them in, presumably letters this size.
Well, we have a couple presses, and we have another really large press that weighs about half a ton that we're going to bring in soon.
Oh, wow, yeah.
But, you know, we...
So people can come and make sort of poster-sized things, really, if they want
to, I guess. Yeah, we've printed a few A3 posters for people and collaborated. Yeah.
And are these made of wood, these ones?
Yes. These are wood type. And
I'm old enough to remember, you know, newsroom at the Auckland Star downtown, and the linotype machines and the stink of hot lead and things. So this is all deeply nostalgic for me, this sort of thing.
Yeah. Well, we're offered a linotype at one time, but we aren't able to accommodate something of that size
of
in
course.
The space.
The huge great monsters they were.
And you have to keep them running in order for them to...
Yeah. Now, one of the other things you're involved with is the production of zines. And I've mentioned zine to somebody recently, and they said, "What on earth do you mean?" So what is a zine?
So we're not just about the production of zines. Both my partner, Moira, who's the other co-director of Alphabet City, and I have made zines and actually met trading the zines through the mail. But zines are...
And there was a zine festival last year, was it? Or was it earlier this year?
Both and. The Zine Fest happens every year. This year it was in August, and last year it was in July. And zines are just self-published small works that people self-identify as a zine. They can be about anything.
So kind of short for magazine, really, in a way.
Short for fanzine, but right. It comes mm-hmm. off, if you're looking for how to pronounce zine, it comes off at the end of
Z-I-N-E, yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so sometimes they're cartoons, aren't they, that people draw?
Sometimes they're comics, they can be personal stories. They're
poetry, I suppose.
Poetry. Mm-hmm. They often revolve around, they're often used photocopy to duplicate, and Alphabet City is a home to New Zealand's largest zine library, and we have about 2,400 titles. And so anyone can just come in off the street and sit down and...
So is there a standard shape and size for a zine?
No.
Is it a certain size or a certain number of pages? Or
anyone, it's all about the person creating the zine deciding what they want to do with it. It's because it's self-publishing, there's no rules.
Yeah.
And you can really, it can be one page folded down into a tiny zine, or you can have something that's 80 pages, 100 pages. So that's a bit more difficult to staple.
And is it necessarily just a hobby, or do people actually sell these and make a buck or three? Yes.
I mean, zines traditionally haven't been about making money. They've been about sharing ideas. But people do sell zines for $1, $2, $3, $5, $10. And there's a big trade economy that happens in zines as well.
Okay. Now, I understand you also have book binding classes so that people can actually learn how to do that age
absolutely.
Old art.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. We're really interested in all sorts of book structures, and so we offer classes in different types of binding, and people have come along and said, oh, I have this idea, and we'll help them realize that idea.
I've heard of people in the past who will take old books and recover them and rejuvenate them, so to speak. Do you do that sort of thing? Or is it more producing new and beautiful things rather than
producing
reworking old ones?
Yeah. More producing new and new things. But if someone was to come in and want to do something creative with an old book, we surely would work with them or help them find the resources to do that.
Now, I looked at your website online, and you have an activity called the Letter Writing Club.
Mm-hmm. There's the Auckland Letter Writing Club.
Lovely picture there of people sitting at these old little portable typewriters, of which I used to own one a long time ago. Clink, 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 king. And I thought, oh gosh, that's so nostalgic. I can't get away from this nostalgia word.
Well, letter writing has never gone away.
Yeah.
It's just shifted who does letter writing. And there are people all over the world who write letters. And we wanted to have a social space around writing letters. And so I knew about some other spaces around the world that did social letter writing clubs. And so we started one. And it's been very popular.
So how does it work?
It's a free event. Yeah. It's the third Thursday of every month. And people come along, and we provide stationery, typewriters, pens, envelopes. You just bring some coins for postage, and you sit down, and you can write a letter. And if you don't have anyone to write a letter to, we've often received some pen pal requests, so we can even hook people up with pen pals.
Oh, right. What, from other letter writing clubs around the world? Or For heaven's sake, that's so much fun in the age of email.
Or people who've just come across the Auckland Letter Writing Club and sent us a letter, not even from other social clubs, but... We definitely are connected with other groups and can hook people up.
So it's not necessarily about typing, though. If you don't want to type, you can
handwrite.
Handwrite, yes. People are starting to think or to fear that handwriting is going away as an art, aren't they? I've heard that a lot of children are finding handwriting particularly difficult these days.
Well, I think it's just about
and even grown-ups. I mean, I find my own handwriting has really deteriorated lately because I'm doing it less often. Yes.
Well, I think it's all about what the schools prioritize. Mm. And a lot of schools do prioritize computer skills over hand motor skills. And so it's just very important to practice, I guess.
Yes. The New Zealand Post Office must love you because you're keeping the post office going, aren't you? With people actually putting letters in envelopes, putting stamps on,
I like to think that we're doing our part. And I have to say, New Zealand makes some really, really gorgeous stamps. New Zealand postage is really beautiful.
Yeah. And the typewriters that you have, is it easy to buy old typewriters like that now? Or have so many been thrown in rubbish dumps that there are not many of them around? And can you get the ribbons
we
anymore
found,
is the problem.
No, we not. Found we import ribbons from Thailand and other places that still use more typewriters than computers, or are still producing. I wouldn't say use more, but are still producing typewriter ribbons?
Well, I suppose there are a lot of countries, like, you know, villages in India or whatever, where there aren't any computers yet and everyone's using typewriters still.
Well, I think that there that I wouldn't say that there's really anywhere that doesn't have computers over and is using only typewriters. I'm not going to make those claims, but I know that we've gotten some typewriter ribbons in the past when we were in Thailand, and also the ribbons last a while. And so we found a lot on TradeMe. People donate us typewriters. We get some at op shops.
How about carbon paper? Does that, is that still viable?
We found some on TradeMe, but we haven't really sourced any new currently.
Oh, it all sounds like a heap of fun. Thank you so much indeed for coming in and telling us about
it. Thank you so much for having me.
Most of the creative stuff you see online or for sale these days seems to be the fruit not of creation, but of curation. Everyone's into curating, gathering bits of other people's work and mixing it up to make something fresh and new. Now, you shouldn't confuse it with plagiarism, because when it's well done, the curator always gives credit to the original source. Case in point is a new book by American illustrator Kerry Smith, How to Be an Explorer of the World. In her preface, she says, "None of the ideas in this book are new. Many of them have been pilfered, borrowed, altered, and stolen from great thinkers and artists of our time." And then she goes on to say she's packed the bibliography with every root source she can find. It's a refreshingly honest approach to something that's always gone on, but hardly ever been acknowledged. Except by smart people like Mark Twain, who apparently once said that all ideas are secondhand. Even what I've just said is secondhand, as I got the idea from a very good website called brainpickings.org, which is itself a curation of many hot ideas. Is there anything original left in the world, do you think? Ian Grant is probably the country's best known parenting expert. He and his wife Mary have been talking to mums and dads for umpteen years about how to raise good kids in supportive families. Just out is his latest book about that crucially important challenge, how dads can step up and be great fathers, something it seems many modern blokes aren't doing too well at. Ian goes so far as to call the lack of fathering a modern nightmare. Hello, Ian. It's such a pleasure to have you on Let's Talk.
Lindsay, nice to be on your show. Yeah. Thank you.
Now, tell me about this painful nightmare. What is it and how has it come about?
Well, I think we've devalued men. And I think there's a change in the climate. I think we've devalued men. And I think when marriages break up, women can express themselves. You know, they're more right-brained, they're more fluent. Men just get angry and walk away. And there's also been that 50s and 60s sort of thinking that, anybody can raise a child. You talk about caregivers. But really, the neuroscience now is saying that a child really deserves a father and a mother. And also that in the 60s, they said it was the same brain. Women use them differently. Men use them differently. Now they're saying the brains are totally different in their compartment size.
Oh, okay. So you mean that right hand, left brain, right brain thing is all a bit of a myth?
Left brain, right brain.
Right.
But, we joke, and it's Hollywood's, when you're making money, you got to work the strategy out. So Hollywood's worked it out. A man's movie is always, he's got a battle to fight, he's got a heroine to rescue, and he's got an adventure to live. Where women's movies are, she wants a man who'll fight for her, not with her. Man who'll treat her as an equal in their life adventure, but loves her even though he doesn't understand how she thinks. And you look at all the classic movies, and I think Hollywood got it right. Now neuroscience is saying that.
Isn't that interesting? What changed 50 years ago, do you think? You say in the past 50 years we've underestimated the role of the father. Was it the arrival of feminism or all sorts of things?
And I think you did have these, what I call parentis sergeant majoricus husbands and men who took control and they ran their, and the woman was here. Mm. And there was a sort of a freedom. There was the sexual revolution too that all came into it. And suddenly women, the world is their oyster. And that's great. But in that whole process, we devalued men. And I think men walked away or they just went quietly into the little caves. And now there's a whole different generation of men. I've seen some of the best fathering I've ever seen, which is wonderful. I've seen some of the worst fathering. But also, women are saying, hey, I don't want to be married to a man who comes home and say, darling, I've had a terrible day at the office. Make a cup of tea. I feel like a good cry. She wants a man who's her protector and provider, but not her control freak. Does that, have I you know?
Yeah. You know? The split between really bad fathering, gosh, we're ever seeing a lot of that, and really good fathering seems to be as big a split as the between affluence and poverty. Everything in society seems to have sort of stretched, doesn't it, in a rather uncomfortable way.
You're absolutely right. And I think that's the breakdown of, I reckon there's four governments in a society. There's central, community, family, and individual. I think the Western world has specialized in individual and central, and we've neglected community and family. And the community one, your neighbors would cover for a dad who wasn't there if he was at the war or whatever, they'd cover for him. That has changed in so many areas.
It seems that more and more people are talking about how essential it is for boys to have a father figure as they hit adolescence. That before then, you know, mum's good at perhaps even being solo mum and doing a wonderful job and things, but by the time they get to that preteen era, boy, do they need a bloke in their lives. So, is this your feeling?
And it's interesting that Celia Lashley, now a woman, she makes a great statement, you know, to mums who are parenting on their own, you know, you can never take your son across the bridge to manhood. He needs a bloke to download the software of how to be a man. And so that's why I'm encouraging mums who are parenting on their own, make sure there's a man in your son's life, like a sports coach or an uncle or a school teacher, to step up, because they think differently. Like, dads are great parents because of the 3 R's, rules, routines, and ridiculousness. And he's the first one to throw the baby in the air. I mean, mothers don't do stupid stuff like that. And the baby thinks, this is different, but dad's smiling. So what he does, and this is important for young women now, because the world is their oyster, they need a dad who teaches them how to take smart risks. And so there's two types of loving a dad has to do. To his son, he's got to have that respectful love. You've got what it takes, mate. To his daughter, you're lovely and you're capable. And she's longing to hear that from her dad.
This is a big book. I mean, it must have taken you a long time
to
write.
No, and there's a big joke. When I rewrote it, my lovely Mary kept saying, you're writing too much. I said, I'm a bloke. It's twice the size of the other one because I've included all the neuroscience, but I haven't bored people with it. I've included the strategies as neuroscience strategies,
Because it's a big book, does it worry you that a lot of blokes aren't going to read it, you know, that it all looks too hard?
Ladies are very smart, you see. Yeah. And one guy said to me, I love this, he was a married gentleman, but he said it in the nice way, and I'm not mocking him, this is the way he said it, oh, it's a good book, eh? My wife brought it for me, she reads it to me in bed, I listen, I could get rewarded. And I think, what a smart lady, you know?
It's written in a really clear, simple, easy, friendly way, though. So,
yeah, well, blokes like that. There's something like that one, you know, if you can say to your children, if you ever want to know if dad loves you, you can sneak up any times and squeeze my arm 4 times, do you love me? I'll squeeze you back 3 times, yes I do. You squeeze me twice, how much? And I go, zillions. And I've got dads now who, that was in the first book and it's back in this one. I've got a dad at the airport told me that his daughter was in Singapore in the hockey rep team, and she was 19 and they just put in her case zillions. And that meant we're with, you know, so it's all those practical tips.
You've got some alarming stuff in there too. I picked up one Aussie research which says that a third of men never talk with their fathers. The next third diss them or mock them. And the final third, they only talk to their fathers on a level of distance about sports or tools or the All Blacks or whatever. Is it the same in New Zealand, do you think?
I think it is, but it's changing. There is a, you know, this dichotomy that's happened. There's a lot of good dads who are really involved in their children's lives and they're working great with their wives and fulfilling great roles. But yeah, that's scary. What's the new one that is even scarier? I interviewed on News Talk ZB Professor Patrick Parkinson. Now, he's the expert in Australia in family law. And he was saying that 1 in 4 Australian teenagers have a mental health issue. Now, you think of that. The Aussies are, no worries, we can do it. How much would it be in New Zealand? And he comes back to a father being there. So, you know, he says, look, if dad separates from the family, he must never speak badly of the mother of his children because the kids don't want that. And the Castle movies, the classic, remember that great Aussie movie? I mean, that guy, it was supposed to be a dysfunctional family. He was smarter than a jolly MRI machine. I mean, You know, and when I interviewed Rob Sitch, who wrote the book, he's a neurosurgeon at Melbourne University, by the way. Mm. That was his dad. And his mother couldn't cook. All she could cook was steamed chicken, steamed fish. The Italian family were having gnocchi and all that. But his dad would say he'd go eating at the flash restaurants, you know, and because of mum's cooking. And that's honouring her. And that's what men are good at, you know, and want to encourage that.
You talk about one of men's problems being in the modern world, that they're overwhelmed by the tyranny of the urgent.
Yeah, I think that's men. They step up quickly, and that's why they get into trouble, you know. And where women often think before they speak, and
do they?
Well, yeah, they do.
Not much that I know.
Well, yeah, well, it's nice to hear it from a lady, isn't it? But it's that sort of she's more concerned with the feelings as well as the facts. So if he gets the facts, he'll start moving on. And what I'm saying to men is, you know, you've got to. When you're talking to a woman, your daughter or your wife, have an imaginary ping pong ball in your head. So when you ask a question, the ping pong ball goes to her. She answers, the ping pong ball comes back to you. You never put the ping pong ball in your pocket, she puts in hers, so you know you've covered the feelings. Mm. And men can handle that sort of thing, and that's the tyranny. He doesn't want to blow it, but he knows he's got to say something, you know?
And just very briefly to end, you've called your book Fathers Who Dare Win. How do you see the future of New Zealand if they keep failing to win.
We're suffering from a huge dad hunger in our society. And before I resigned from Parents Inc., we were doing corporates, because now you bring your domestic issues to work, which you never did 50 years ago. I would have very talented women come up and either say, I am so glad my dad encouraged me and gave me the message I'm lovely and capable, or they'd have tears in their eyes and say, you know, I long for my dad to say that. Mm. And men the same. And I think New Zealand's small enough. It's only 4.5 million. We could turn it around, and that's my dream. Let's turn around. Let's make it a great place to bring up kids.
And Father's Day this Sunday, it's something for us all to think about, isn't it? Thank you so much, Ian Grant.
Hey, great being on show, Lindsay. Thank you.
We've had the Olympics, and now it's the Paralympics, and then dear old London will just have to settle down and be itself again. But that Union Jack-waving patriotism will never die, as is made plain by this mini-ad made in the run-up to the Games. It's very amusing and clever, although nobody dares to mention, of course, that the car company is actually owned by BMW, which is a German company. Carole from the Women's Bookshop. It's great to see you again, and I see you've got a really intriguing looking book in here today.
Yes, it's one that's causing quite a bit of interest overseas because the basic concept of it is so intriguing, really. The Age of Miracles, it's called, by Karen Thompson Walker. First novel, causing a huge amount of interest. It's a post-apocalyptic novel, but it is one with a difference, because the basic concept is that very slowly, initially imperceptibly, the Earth's rotation starts to slow. No one knows what's caused it, but it starts to slow. So gradually, there's a few minutes added to each day. The sun sets a bit later.
What a fascinating thought.
And a bit later, and a bit later, until in the end you have days that are hours and hours longer, and finally days that become days and days and days, until a day becomes 3 weeks, and nights go on forever.
And the calendar is a complete and total nonsense, and yes. nobody knows when Christmas is.
Exactly. And it's fascinating because one way of coping with it, and in fact the official way of coping with it, once it's, I mean, it happens very gradually. I mean, the byline at the top of the book says it was, at the beginning, a quite invisible catastrophe. And that's really good, because initially people don't realise. Gradually, as people realise what's happening, officially governments and so on decide that society will stick to the clock. Because you can't actually have Monday being 3 weeks long, and then Monday night being 3 weeks long, and so on. And so they stick to the clock, but you have a group of people, groups of people in various societies, in various countries, who don't agree to this, who stick to the actual days as they really are. So they have a Monday that's 3 weeks long eventually. And they move to particular, little enclaves of their own. One in particular is out in the desert, and what actually happens is that when you've had the sun up for 3 weeks at a time, it becomes so intense and so hot that you become terribly sunburnt and so on. It becomes intolerable. So it also affects gravity. So birds start dropping out of the air. Trees and plants.
Well, agriculture would be stuffed, wouldn't it?
Yeah, completely. Yeah. Eventually, completely and utterly.
Fish,
it happens slowly.
Fish would die.
Exactly. And so people have, eventually each house has its own sort of greenhouse in the garden, but it's a thing that's completely protected from the sun and from the dark, and has its own artificial light, and food is being starts to be produced internationally by artificial light and so on. Absolutely fascinating, the whole thing.
I was just going to ask you, how long a period does the book cover? But I suppose even that concept doesn't work anymore when time doesn't exist anymore.
It's fascinating. It's absolutely fascinating. And I mean, the young girl, it's told through the eyes of a teenage girl called Julia. And she's a lovely character. And I mean, she's still alive telling the story at the end of the book, so you don't really know what's going to happen. But there have been personal disasters as well, because some individual humans are affected by a certain illness that actually affects their body metabolism is affected. Mm-hmm. It affects some people and not others and so on. That actually affects Julia's mother. It reveals fascinating things about relationships. So there's on a very human level, people are affected. They become more reckless. They don't take the sort of precautions they might have taken otherwise. They don't know what's going to happen to life. So
Does it also have a scientific background? I mean, is it a believable thing to read?
Well, I think she's done a huge amount of events. Oh, it feels totally believable when you read it, but it's told very quietly. So it's like this very quiet, ghastly thing that is happening, but it's told with a sort of quiet dignity, really.
You can see it being a masterful movie in the right hands, or a total dog in the wrong hands, but sounds fascinating.
So it's not normally my sort of book, but I did find it quite intriguing. It's well done.
Really readable.
Yes.
Thank you so much, Carole. The Age of Miracles. Thanks for watching. Next week, we've got top inspirational speaker John Shackleton in to talk about his book, Life is for Living, How to Exercise Your Brain, and how swimming is good for just about everything.
Supporting local content so you can see more of New Zealand on air.